People of America, you should vote for me, your Republican candidate, Amber Steven, as your 2020 president.
No. People of America, vote for me, your Democratic candidate, Kate Lawrence.
No, don't listen to her. She's a dumb Democrat who doesn't know what she's talking about. Her views on immigration and social rights are wrong.
I'm the right one here. You are completely and utterly wrong. Vote for me.
Vote for me. Don't vote for her. She's a stupid face.
Pete, I think we have a problem here.
What do you mean, Soph?
This is a serious case of political polarization, which is when an individual's given stance on a topic most likely aligns with their political party. If we don't fix this now, things could get really bad.
You're right. I think I have an idea.
How dare you call me a stupid face?
I called you a stupid face because you are a stupid face. All Democrats are stupid faces.
Well, all Republicans are duty heads.
Excuse me. Hello? Two time travelers here.
You're right. This is getting bad. Quick.
Leave us alone. You nobodies are getting in the way of me tearing apart this Republican.
Do you guys even know what you're fighting about?
Who are you guys?
I'm Soph.
And I'm Pete.
And we're time travelers. We are going to take you through time to show you what happens when two political parties fight.
Fine. If we have to.
Ha ha. Beep, beep, beep.
Where are we?
You're in Greece. Ancient Greece.
Why Greece? What does it have to do with us?
This is the birthplace of democracy in Athens. It transitioned from an oligarchy. This began to make the lives of the poorer citizens much better and give equal opportunity to all.
You see, the rich were the only ones that could afford to pay for armor, so they were the only ones allowed to fight. The poorer citizens couldn't afford to pay the armor, so they were only allowed to fight in small disputes. Something needed to change.
Well, that's just not fair. Everyone should be allowed to fight.
Hey, if they could spend the money, that's more important than giving the poor citizens the brief satisfaction of helping their city-state.
You're just a terrible person.
All right, calm down, you guys. There's much more to democracy than just making everything equal.
Their government started to include councils, assemblies, and presidents. All of these things help to run their city-states much more smoothly and include equal opportunities for all.
That's right. While direct democracy was very popular in the Greek city-states, it didn't really spread that much thereafter. But it did spread to one place in the 1700s called the Americas. Beep, 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 beep. Welcome to the birth of America.
So, what year is it now?
We are in the late 1700s, and our country has just experienced the first ever emergence of separate political parties.
You mean like rockstar Republicans and dinky Democrats?
Ugh.
Hold your horses, guys. Before you start arguing, let's first learn how these political parties developed. Take it away, Soph.
Well, after the Revolutionary War, George Washington, the general of the Continental Army, had so much public support that he was unanimously elected into office both times when there were public elections.
You mean he got all the electoral votes? Even the ones from the opposing parties?
That's the catch. There were no political parties. The whole idea of left and right or blue and red wasn't even thought of yet. And for the first time in American history, the entire public was united in their president.
Yeah, you are right. George Washington had the highest approval ratings of all U.S. presidents.
Well, the country began to become divided when he stepped down from office.
Yep. In 1796, there were two presidential candidates, Thomas Jefferson and John Adams.
Do you remember who won the election?
That's right! John Adams was the second president of the United States. However, each candidate represented a separate political party. John Adams for the Federalists, and Thomas Jefferson for the Anti-Federalists.
But how did these two sides just emerge?
Well, our country was facing a huge turning point as people were debating over the Constitution. The Federalists prefer having a stronger federal government, where the Anti-Federalists preferred having more power to the people.
That makes sense. The political parties united over a common public issue.
Now you're getting it. The only thing is, these political parties didn't really bode well for the American public. In fact, George Washington himself called these political parties a representation of the division of the American people. And boy, could he have not been more correct.
The moment these two political parties developed, they became polar opposites. Heck, they're even called the Federalists and the Anti-Federalists.
Geez, that sounds a lot like today's political climate.
And the similarities don't stop there. Ever since the development of these two mortal enemies, politics got heated. The elections of 1796 and 1800 were so chock full of personal insults and press involvement. In fact, the election of 1800 was so heated that it almost sparked an entire civil war.
Well, it clearly got better over the years.
I beg to differ, but to show you why, we need to get to a different time period and leave this one behind.
Boop, 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 boop.
Washington, D.C., June 2nd, 1865. Any guesses what's significant about today?
Not totally sure. Wait, was it with some assassination?
For once, I might have to give Kate on this one. Those dates are scrambled in my head.
Close, but not quite. Today is the end of the American Civil War. We just jumped 65 years into the future.
Yep. At this time, our country is so divided by these political parties that one of those parties decided to completely separate itself from the other and form a whole new nation.
The Democratic Party was formed initially in 1802 by James Madison and Thomas Jefferson. The Republican Party was initially founded in the 1850s by Northerners that wanted to abolish slavery.
Republican candidate Abraham Lincoln was elected in the 1860 election, and he served until his assassination in 1865. It was his inauguration that led the South to secede from the Union.
Whoa, whoa, whoa. Okay, I get the whole history lesson, but I feel like you're missing a pretty huge part. Why did the war happen in the first place?
Stupid question. Don't you know our nation's history? Stupid, stupid, stupid.
Well, then what's the answer, Miss Know-It-All?
Know-It-All? Who do you think you are? Duty head!
Stupid face!
Stop pulling my tie!
Stop pulling my hair!
I can't!
If you two hotheads could let us finish, we would be happy to answer your questions. Now, how did the Civil War begin, Soph?
The Civil War itself was a dispute over economic practices, but these economic practices were set in the differing political ideologies.
And when the recession of 1850 occurred, raising taxes beat down the South's already weakening economy, which made it really easy to go to war.
We will return to Liberty Teens after this brief commercial break.
And now, back to your regularly scheduled programming.
These tensions really derive from one big thing. The South believed that slavery was morally correct, and the North believed the exact opposite. This allowed the war to be highly based on moral decisions.
In response to this split, Lincoln initially claimed that his focus was on reuniting the Union, not really freeing the slaves. As time progressed and the war intensified, he made more and more efforts to free slaves using the Emancipation Proclamation.
You lost me. So what you're saying is, what now? My brain is being pulled into a million different directions.
Well, look who's confused now.
Enough, you two. This lesson teaches us just how brutal political polarization can be. The differences culturally between the North and the South because of this war are still very prominent today.
Even after the war, these cultural differences were very prominent. The assassination of Lincoln is a prime example of how political polarization motivated murder.
The Confederate John Wilkes Booth shot President Lincoln just because of differing political ideologies. If we don't begin to solve this deepening political divide, we may be on the road to civil war again.
Wait, wait, wait!
the 60s, baby. And 16 years ago, earlier, in 1952, it was the year of the Eisenhower and Truman election. Truman was the Democrat, while Eisenhower was the Republican. And, you know, they had many differing ideas on the aspects and policies of government.
Mm-hmm. Eisenhower wanted to end the Korean War, while Truman wanted to continue to fight. This led to many conflicts between the two.
Who won?
Well, Eisenhower, by a landslide.
Aha, yes, the Republican takes it.
Now, in 1968, was the year that Nixon was elected president. He promised law and order.
But the real story is when Robert F. Kennedy, the brother of John F. Kennedy, was assassinated on June 5th, 1968.
What? He was killed? Why?
Well, he was a huge advocate for African-American civil rights, and he was a shoo-in for the Democratic nominee.
Who killed him?
Well,
his name was Sirhan Sirhan.
Mm-hmm. Sirhan later admitted that he believed Kennedy was oppressing the Palestinian people.
Kennedy later died in the hospital on June 6th, 1968.
Wow. He could have been president. I don't think I could ever kill someone because of that, even if I had something against them.
I could never do it.
You know, well, I think it's time we move on from this.
I think they're catching on, Pete.
Mm-hmm.
Wait!
Ah, the infamous 2016 election campaign of Trump versus Hillary.
This was truly one for the history books. This is a prime example of how political polarization was used in more modern times.
Well, now before you both start squabbling about emails and pussy cats, we must identify some important ground facts regarding your events.
In the years surrounding 2016, Republican and Democratic supporters, for the most part, had opposing opinions on things such as immigration, women's rights, environmental issues, and so much more.
Just like in the 1992 election of Bush versus Clinton. Bush attacked Clinton and said that he was questioning his patriotism because Clinton was organizing anti-Vietnam demonstrations.
Furthermore, the media was once again a powerful manipulator in this election. As tempers rose and election day crept closer and closer, so-called investigative reports played a critical role in the portrayal of each candidate. In other words, the media's coverage of each presidential candidate and their corresponding scandals greatly influenced the public opinion of each candidate.
The division of each political party was a strong focal point during this time frame. In everyday society, everyone suddenly had a label: Republican, Democrat, conservative, liberal, left and right. These terms alone had a huge impact on how we viewed one another.
Political ideology and identification became all that defined who someone was. Because of the sheer separation of these political parties, it produced the idea that if one's beliefs don't align with another person's beliefs, you can't be compatible human beings.
Social media also perpetuated the conflict. Twitter wars, comment section battles, propaganda all contributed to the division between Republican and Democrat.
The social media also helped to spread the conflict and fire to the younger generations. As the election drew closer and closer, the conflict in all ages, from middle-aged moms on Facebook to teens on Instagram, intensified.
Case in point.
This entire journey has been to show you the path that led to this issue. If you and the rest of the U.S. continue in this path of conflict, there's a possibility for drastic consequences.
I never really thought about it that way. This conflict does seem like we are pitting us against each other solely based on our political parties. Maybe that should be changed.
I can't believe I'm about to say this, but I actually agree with her. We shouldn't hold so much hostility and contempt against those who solely based on who they identify as.
We couldn't agree more.
Well, not to say this division didn't help shed some light on some important issues. Despite the differences between the politicians and political parties, we stress the importance of not letting the differences indicating them separate over our nation.
During the election and post-election timeframe, there have been some incredible experiences of unity and happiness. Take the Women's March and the U.S. coming together in times of grief, especially during when countries were having problems with terrorist attacks, internationally and domestically.
But I think it's time we move on.
We hope that you've learned from this journey and take what we've said into consideration so you can take that step and heal the United States.
Wait, you can't just leave us here.
But until the next episode, Liberty Teens, out!
Boop, boop, boop!
Matter to me right now. I have something to say to you.
If you insult me one more time, you're going down.
I just wanted to say I'm sorry for calling you a duty head.
I'm sorry for calling you a stupid face.
I think we learned our lesson. We shouldn't fight.
And we know that even though there will be disagreements and conflicts between the two parties, we shouldn't let it get to us.
If we don't control this conflict, it could eventually lead to a war, or maybe something even worse.
We need to unite as a nation, but have the freedom to have our own opinions.
I'm done fighting with you.
May the best candidate win.
But you should still vote for me.